हेलो फ्रेंड्स, सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विथ सेंसर्स इन डिफरेंट एप्लीकेशन एरिया. सो वील बी लुकिंग एट पोजिशन डिस्प्लेसमेंट एंड लेवल डिटेक्टर्स. इन लास्ट लेक्चर, इन प्रीवियस वीडियो, वी हैव सीन द हॉल इफेक्ट सेंसर, देन मैग्नेटिक एंड इंडक्टिव टाइप ऑफ सेंसर्स दैट आर यूज फॉर पोजिशन एंड डिस्प्लेसमेंट मेजरमेंट. सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द मैग्नेटो रजिस्टिव टाइप ऑफ सेंसर. इट इज सिमिलर टू द हॉल इफेक्ट सेंसर. इट वर्क्स ऑन अ एक्सटर्नल मैग्नेटिक फील्ड, सो इट इज रिक्वायर्स एक्सटर्नल मैग्नेटिक फील्ड. सो परमानेंट मैग्नेट इज यूज फॉर मेजरमेंट ऑफ लीनियर डिस्प्लेसमेंट. सो द लीनियर डिस्प्लेसमेंट आइदर इन एक्स डायरेक्शन और वाई डायरेक्शन. So when a sensor is placed in a magnetic field, it is exposed in both the direction, x as well as y direction. So magnet is oriented with its axis parallel to the strip. So we'll consider it as a x direction. So hx will be the auxiliary field, and the variation in hy, that is the field perpendicular to the x direction, is called as a hy. Is the measurement of x direction. Now let us consider that both hx and hy vary with x. That means if we move in a x direction, then hx as well as hy is going to vary. So, but hx will never vary a particular limit, that is the maximum field plus minus hx. And let us consider that this initially the magnet is at x is equal to 0 position. That means it is at 0th position. The sensor and the magnet are at the one position only. So I'll consider it as the x is equal to 0 position. So obviously h of y is equal to 0. And hx will be maximum at that time. Now, once you start, so this is what the field shown over here. So you can see that this is the magnet, this is the magnetic field, and the sensor is here. So this is the sensor, okay? And you will be moving in this direction. So hx will be in this direction and hy will be in the direction. So any moment in this direction, in x direction, will going to change hx as well as hy. So how it is going to change, let us try to understand it. Now let us consider that when x is equal to 0, when x is equal to 0, what happens at that time, hx is maximum. At that time, hx is maximum. And as you start moving towards this one, so hx is going to reduce. Hx is going to reduce. Or if you move in an opposite direction also, hs is going to reduce. So hx will never cross this maximum value plus hx and minus hx. This is what the meaning of this. Okay? Now, this is what the output you are getting. So, this is the output shown over here. So, this is the output you are getting. This output. This is the output you are getting. So, this output is the measurement of your displacement. So, when you move at a particular distance, so hx will become 0 and output will be the maximum one. So, that output will be proportional to this hx. And you move further, hx is going to reduce it. But simultaneously, this output is also going to reduce. So this is how you are going to calculate the distances with respect to that one. So when a sensor movement in a plus x direction, hy that and vo increases and hx falls to 0, where and then increases negatively with until hy exceeds minus hx of. Okay. So this is what we have calculated. I have shown you over here. So this plus hx and minus hx. So these points are called as a point A and B. So the movement you can easily find it out. If the output is positive and if the output is negative, you can easily find out the direction also. So this will be the movement from A to B. So here you can see that this is the movement from A to B. This is the movement from A to B. The point A and B, where the crossing is there. So at this point the sensor characteristics flips and the output of the voltage is reversed. So here the output is reversed. Now output is reversed and it will move towards the negative one. if the sensor is moved in opposite direction, then hx increases until it reaches to the plus hx. Okay, hx increases until it moves to the plus hx, and vo moves it from b to c. Now you can see that the movement is in the reverse direction, because you are moving now in this direction. So this output will increase and hx will reach to output will reach to this c point. And at this point the sensor characteristics again flip and it will reach to d, c to d. Now it will reach from c to d. Now you can see that this moment and this moment is similar but in opposite direction. Okay, so there is one single KM110 sensor is there for detecting the rotation and the direction of tooth wheel. So if you want to measure the rotation and the direction of tooth wheel, that means whether the tooth wheel or the gear tooth, if you want to measure its direction or rotation, then this KM110 sensor is utilized. So this sensor operates like a magnetic Wheatstone bridge, measuring the non-symmetrical magnetic condition, such as when the teeth or the pin move in front of sensor. So we have already seen the concept of that one. So whenever the teeth will come near to this magnetic field, so it is going to produce the pulse, or it is going to produce the output which is proportional to the displacement of that tooth. So both the axes must coincide. So when they will coincide, that will create the output. The circuit connects the bridge output to the corresponding amplifier and subsequently the low pass filter and the Schmitt trigger to form a rectangular output signal. In last lecture we have seen such kind of output generation. You will be getting a square output whenever a tooth comes to the proximity sensor. I am talking about the proximity sensor which works on a principle of Hall effect or any other magnetic principle. So whenever the tooth comes near to, now let us consider that this is the your sensor and this is the tooth wheel. Okay, so whenever it comes nearer to this one, it will generate a pulse like this. So this is what we have seen in the last lecture. So a phase difference between the both outputs is an indication of a rotation direction. So if phase is positive or a phase is negative, then in that case you can easily find out what kind of difference or the rotation, whether it is a clockwise or whether it is anti-clockwise, you can easily find it out its direction. So here it is, the example is given to you. So this is the diagram. So a direction is direction 1 and direction 2. Direction 2 is clockwise and direction 1 is anti-clockwise. So this is the tooth wheel and this is the KM110 BH31 type of sensor which works on a magneto-resistive type of principle. So it is used, it is connected in a bridge type of amplification, and you will be getting the output V01 and V02. So if it is in the direction V01, V01 will get in direction 1, so output of this V01 will be high if you are in direction 1, and output of V02 will be high if you are in direction 2. So you can easily find it out in which direction the wheel is moving. So that direction you can easily find it out. So here it is the output V01 and V02. So the output V01 leads V02, or V02, and this time difference you can easily find it out. So this phase difference, this is the phase difference you will be getting over here. So this difference will tell you what kind of output you are getting, and depending on that you can decide the direction. Now you can see that this is for direction 1, this is for direction 1, and this is for direction 2. Now you can see that there is a difference. So VO1 is positive in this case and VO2 is positive in this case. So or vice versa, you can design it accordingly. So any of the output, if V01 is high, then in that case I can say that it is a clockwise direction, and if V02 is high, then in that case I can say that it is an anticlockwise direction. Okay. So a transducer can measure the displacement with a high resolution across the long distance, can be built using the magnetorestrictive and ultrasonic technologies. So magnetoresistive type of resistor which is used for a small distance, but if you want to go for a longer distance, then in that case a concept called as a magnetostrictive detector is used. Now this is will be moving towards the next sensor, which is similar to the previous principle, but now the distance, if you want to go for a longer distance, this either you'll be using the ultrasonic technology or you'll be using magnetostrictive principle. So transducer is comprised of two major parts. First one is a long waveguide and a permanent ring magnet. So permanent ring magnet and a long waveguide. Now what is that long waveguide and how the actual structure looks like, we are going to see it soon. So magnet can move freely along the waveguide without touching it. So the position of the magnet is stimulus, which is converted by the sensor into electrical output signal. So magnet is a free and it is moving along the waveguide. So if I consider this is a waveguide, this is a waveguide which carries electromagnetic signal, and if you put a magnet across this, so this is a magnet, so this magnet is free to move without touching this waveguide, and this is going to create the electrical output signal. So the stimulus or the position of the magnet is the stimulus. So when you move the magnet, so it is going to produce a stimulus to the waveguide, and that is get converted into electrical output signal. So waveguide contains a conductor. Upon applying the electrical pulse, this sets up a magnetic field over the entire length. So whenever I am passing a current through this conductor, it will have its own magnetic field, and I am again applying the external magnetic field. So these two fields oppose each other, that's why it is called as a magnetostrictive detector. It is restricting themselves, the magnetic field is restricting themselves. So that effect you are going to identify over here, that's why the principle is called as a magnetostrictive detector. So another magnetic field is produced by the permanent magnet, which is in the vicinity of that waveguide. So this is going to oppose, the two fields will oppose each other. So the two magnetic fields may be set up at a point where the permanent magnet is located. So the superposition of the two fold is the resultant magnetic field, which can be found from the vector summation. So if the both the magnetic fields are in same direction, then obviously the effective magnetic or resultant magnetic field will be very high, and if it is in opposite direction, obviously it will that means let us consider that this is the waveguide and the current is in the same direction, and you are moving the magnet in this direction only. So what will happen? The field direction created by the waveguide and the field direction created by this one, so depending on that, the field may be generated, and that field, the effective magnetic field, is a net magnetic field, which is the vector summation. So it depends on whether the two magnetic fields are in the same direction or the two magnetic fields are opposing each other. If the two magnetic fields are in the same direction, obviously the net magnetic field will be high, and if they are opposing each other, obviously the net magnetic field will be less. So you can easily find out the direction accordingly. So the net magnetic field, although a helical formed around the waveguide, causes it to experience a minute torsional strain or twist in the location of the at the location of the magnet. So you can find the twist. So if this is what the magnet is over here, so you can find it a twist over here at this point. And that twist is called as Weidman effect. This is called as a Weidman effect. So this Weidman effect is because of that magnetic field present at the external as well as the waveguide magnetic field, they will experience a torsion, a strain or a twist in a waveguide, and that effect is called as a Weidman effect. So this is what the principle, or this is what the structure of this magnetorestrictive type of detector. You can see that this is a waveguide, this is a waveguide, this is a waveguide, and you are passing the current is there. So this is a conducting element is there which is passing a current. So it will have its own magnetic field because of the pulse applied to this conductor, and there is a magnet, this is the magnet which is creating its own magnetic field. Now this is the external magnetic field and this is the internal magnetic field. Now these magnetic fields, either they may be in one direction depending on the pulse and the movement of the your. So what you will find, so at this moment you will find a twist here because of the external magnetic field and the internal magnetic field. So there will be a twist. So that twist will be able, you are able to find it out. So this is the sensing coil. So this twist here, the twist, that this twist will also cause the effect at this end also. So this may move towards either this sensing coil or this may move towards this sensing coil, and accordingly you can find out the output at this, and this output will be proportional to the effect at this moment or at this position. So the advantage of this sensor is that its linearity is very high, good repeatability is there, and it has a long term stability. So the sensor can withstand with an aggressive environment such as high pressure, high temperature, strong type of radiations. Another advantage is that it also work at a low temperature sensitivity, is very good one, and you need to define it with a 20 ppm per degree centigrade. So application of this sensor includes hydraulic cylindrical cylinders, injection molding machines, then the mining applications, rolling mills, press gear, forges, elevators. So most of the time it is a mechanical industry which use such kind of applications of such kind of detectors.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, next sensors that are used for position and displacement and level detectors are optical sensors. So optical sensors are also used for position, displacement and level detectors. Now the main advantage of optical sensor is its simplicity, the absence of loading effect. That means most of the mechanical sensors there is a loading effect, but here in this case optical sensor there is no loading effect. So obviously you can measure a long operative distances also with the help of such kind of sensors. So these are insensitive to the stray magnetic field as well as electrostatic interferences. So this is what, because the light doesn't get affected because of magnetic field and electrostatic interferences. So that is what the advantage of this optical sensor. So optical sensors are usually requires at least three essential components. First one is the light source, second one is the photodetector, and a light guidance device. That means a source, light source is there, detector is there, and a waveguide is required. So waveguide, I'll call it as a light guidance device, so which will carry the light. So that may be a fiber optic, that may be a mirror, that may be a lens, and so forth. So optical bridge is the first sensor which is used as an optical sensor. So optical bridge, it consists of four quadrant photodetectors consisting of four light detectors connected in a bridge like circuit. So we will see the structure over there, and you can understand how the optical bridge is formed. The object must have an optical contrast against the background. So whenever the light falls, so we can easily find it out on object. So we can easily find out object from its background. So the optical contrast is there, and that optical contrast you are able to measure it with the help of such kind of optical bridge. So this is what the example is shown over here. So here you can see that this is the first bridge, this first photo detector, this is the second, this is the third, and this is the fourth, which is connected in terms of bridge. So optical bridge is connected. So considering the position of the system, specifically spacecraft, if you are using it, an image of a sun or any other sufficiently bright object is focused by an optical system on a four quadrant photo detector. So you are launching a spacecraft, and the sun is the highest object, which is a brightest object. So that object is need to be focused on this optical system. So these four quadrant photo detectors are used in such kind of spacecrafts. So opposite parts of the detector are connected to the corresponding inputs of difference amplifiers. That means 1 and 3 is in series, and 2 and 4, they are connected to the difference amplifier. Means combination of 1 and 3 and 2 and 4 are connected to the difference amplifier. So this is how it can be used. You can see that this is the sun and this is the optical system. So this optical system will reflect it back. So whatever may be the rays that will come, so the first ray that will be aligned with this sun, let us consider that, and the reflector system will reflect it back, and this will be sensed by this sensor, photo detector sensor, a bridge sensor. So here you can see that this is the structure 1 2 3 4. Here you can see that 1 2 3 4. So such kind of sensors are used for these applications. Now how this is connected? 1 and 3 is connected to Y's amplifier, and 2 and 4 are connected to X amplifier. So this will give you the difference, and that difference is given to the next instrumentation amplifier, and you will get the output according to the displacement. So each amplifier produces the output proportional to the displacement of image from the optical center. So optical center is at center place, and if you move towards one direction or if you move towards the other direction, this is going to change the contrast, and that is going to create the output proportional to the displacement. So when the image is perfectly centered, both the output will produce the same output. So the overall output of the amplifier will be zero, and if it move in a single direction, in one direction or in another direction, then at that time it is going to create a difference between the amplifier output VY and amplifier output VX, and that is proportional to the displacement. Okay, now the next sensor is a proximity detector with polarized light. The next optical sensor is proximity detector with polarized light. So polarized light, we have already seen this principle of light, that the fields are polarized. The electric field that is present, or the E, is present in that one, and that is parallel to the perpendicular to the field. So such kind of principle that we have already seen in the previous principle of sensors. So that concept is used over here. So each photon light has a specific magnetic and electric field, and this magnetic and electric field, they are perpendicular to each other. They are perpendicular to each other. This is what the principle of this polarized light is. So the direction of electric field is the direction of light polarization. So most of the light sources produces the light with a random polarized photon. Now you need to focus it. So for that purpose, you will be requiring the filters. So to make the light polarized, you will require the polarizing filters. It is a special material which transmits the light polarized in only one direction and absorbs the other wrong polarization or other directions light. So it will pass only in one direction. So any direction of polarization can be represented as a geometrical sum of two orthogonal polarization. One is same as the filter and second is non-passing. So by rotating the polarization right, polarization of the light before the filter, we can gradually change the light intensity of the filter output. So we will explain it with the help of example, you can understand it. So when the polarized light strike the object, the reflected light may contain its polarization, that is a specular reflection, or the polarization angle may change because of non-metallic object. And the filter which is we are using in between, that will capture the light in the same direction only, and whatever the angular moment is there, that will get filtered. So you are able to find it out and the light intensity will be accordingly managed. So when a sensor is non-resistive, non-sensitive to the reflective object like metal can, foil wrappers, then in that case it includes the two perpendicular position polarized filter. So one is aligned to the light source and other is at detector. So here it is the example, you can see that. So this is the proximity detector and here it is your the specular reflector. So you are sending a light and you are trying to calculate. So you can see that this is one polarization filter which is parallel to this one and this is perpendicular to this one. So you can find it out the polarization accordingly. So this is called as a specular filter. So specular filter means it is in the polarization. So you are having a polarization either in this direction or perpendicular to this direction. Now what will happen? So this is a non-metallic type of filter. You will be getting the same filter over here. So you to this direction and this direction, now the reflection is there. Now you can see that here only one direction you are getting. Here the direction is in x as well as this y direction. Here now the action is in x as well as y direction. Now the polarization, you can see that this is the polarization in horizontal direction or perpendicular to the direction of the transmitter one. So the first filter is positioned at emitting light to the polarized outgoing light. Then the second filter receiving the lens, it allows to pass only the component of light which is having 90 degree rotation. Okay. So when the light is reflected from a specular reflector, its polarization does not change and receiving filter will not allow to pass it to the photodetector. So you are not getting the light to the photodetector and you will find it that this is a specular reflector. And if it is a non-specular type of reflector, then the sufficient amount of polarization light go through the receiving filter also and it activates the detector, and accordingly you can make the position on and off. So you can find it out whether the detector or the metal, the object is metal or whether the object is non-metal. So such kind of detection you can do it. So you can find it out the position of that object and you can find it out the type of that one also. So the use of polarization reduces the false positive direction of non-metallic objects. Now the third one, optical sensor, is the thickness and a level sensor. Sorry, we have already seen the two optical sensors. Now the next position, displacement and level sensor, is you have to measure the thickness as well as level sensor. So here in many industrial applications, you are measuring the thickness of the material. So you have to measure the thickness of the material, mostly in manufacturing industry or a process control, for a safety of airspace. And in many applications, you have to measure either the level or you have to measure the thickness of the particular material. So these applications where such kind of sensor are used, so the method of thickness gauging ranges from optical to ultrasonic to x-rays. That means either we can use the optical sensor, either we may use the ultrasonic sensor, or we may use the x-rays to find out the thickness of the material. Then there are three types of sensor. First one is the oblation sensor. So these oblation sensors are generally utilized in aircrafts or where the surface is changing its property, when it gets exposed to the environment, at that time this ablation sensor is utilized. So ablation is the dissipation of heat by melting and removal of the sacrificial protective layer during the atmospheric re-entry. So whenever the material is entering in the atmosphere, specifically aircrafts, at that time its surface is coated with a particular material which goes through the, it will be generated. Obviously there will be a friction of air, and that is the aerodynamic principle is used. So we need to study that aerodynamic principles. So to have a less friction at the surface of the your aircraft, so the surface is designed in a such a way that with a certain material, so that will show the ablation. So what is that ablation? Ablation is nothing but it is a dissipation of heat because of that friction by melting and removal of the protective layer. So such kind of principles are used in many applications. So the ablating thermal protection system undergoes the chemical decomposition or a phase change below the internal structure critical structure's critical temperature. So we need to keep safe that the structure below this protection layer, that is ablating protection layer, and that ablating sensor will give you the information about what is happening at the surface. So incident thermal energy is channelized into melting, subliming and decomposing the ablator. So the ablator recession rate is directly proportional to the flux at the surface. Whatever may be the energy, thermal energy that is radiant on the surface, that recession rate of this sensor is directly proportional to that energy. So measure of the ablator thickness is required to estimate the surface of the heat flux. So ablation sensor is a kind of position sensor that detects the position of the ablation layer outer surface, and it provides a measure of remaining thickness. So ablation sensor can be built into the ablation layer, which may be a intrusive type of sensor or it is a non-invasive type of sensor. So intrusive type of sensor includes a brake wire ablation gauge, then radiating transducer sensor and a light pipe. A non-invasive type of sensor which measures the ablation layer, which can build by using a capacitive method. So we'll see this capacitive method, how it will work. The sensor is placed in a series with an inductor and a resistor, forming a RLC circuit. So you put this sensor in series with inductor and a resistor. So obviously your ablating sensor is used as a capacitor. So that is going to change the capacitive value, and that will change the RLC resonance, and that RLC resonance you can easily find it out, and resonant frequency you can get it initially, and after that you can easily find it out what is the resonant frequency. So that resonant frequency is given by, so at resonance 1 upon 2 pi under root LC is the resonant frequency for this RLC combination is given. So here it is the circuit. Here you are giving the reflection VHF oscillations. This reflection coefficient bridge is giving it out. This coaxial cable will carry this one. This inductor and R is connected in series with this ablation layer. So this thickness of this ablation layer is going to change the capacitance value, and that is going to change this RLC characteristics. And if this RLC characteristics is going to change, obviously this reflection coefficient bridge is going to change the output, which is proportional to this resonance frequency caused because of this ablation layer. So this thickness will change, and that thickness will cause the change in RLC factor, and that RLC factor will change the resonance frequency, which is proportional to the thickness of that ablation layer. Now next, thickness, you can measure it with the help of thin film sensor. So thin film sensor, these thin film sensors are used for mechanical gauges, optical or electromagnetic or capacitive type of measurements. You'll be using this film range for measuring the mechanical gauges to optical or electromagnetic or capacitive type of principles. You can use it for measurement of thickness of any material. So you can use this principle for measurement of the thickness. The optical method are limited to the transparent or semi-transparent film, because you need to pass the light, and that passing of the light depends upon the thin film. So if the film is transparent or semi-transparent, then you can measure the optical method or light detected on the detector side, that is proportional to the thickness of your film. A capacitive sensor, you can measure the thickness of liquid film. So you can use the capacitive sensor. You can use the liquid film thickness, that is measured via capacitance between the two small wire probes. That is immersed in a liquid, and whenever the liquid moves, the same principle is also used in your level detector also. So when a liquid is there in between the two wires, so that liquid thickness is directly affecting the capacitance of the two wires. So because two wires acts as a plate, and the liquid between the two wires will act as a dielectric material, and the thickness of that dielectric is going to affect your the capacitance value. So the liquid acts as a dielectric between the two plates. So here you can see, here you will be putting the dielectric. So these two wires acts as a capacitor plate, and this is acting as a dielectric material. So it has its own dipole directions. And this is going to put, so whenever the film you are putting it there, and you immerse these two wires in that material, then the thickness of that film will tell you the thickness of the film, so or liquid. So liquid film will be formed, and that thickness of that liquid film will affect the capacitance value, and you can measure the capacitance value, or you can connect this C into interfacing circuit, and you can measure C to V conversion, and you can get the value accordingly. So if the liquid has a different dielectric constant than air, a change in liquid level will result in change in probe of the capacitance. That is what we have discussed, and the frequency modulation circuit, we need to design it. So a fixed frequency was the input to the circuit, and when the capacitance is changing, obviously this is going to change the frequency, and that change in frequency is proportional to the change in capacitance, and the change in capacitance is proportional to the thickness. So I can say that the change in frequency is proportional to the thickness value of the dielectric film. So this is how you can check the one of the example of this one. You can see that here it is the base, and the dielectric film having thickness of this much size. So this is the thickness. So if this thickness is there, obviously this is going to move the ball upward, and that is going to change the capacitance, and that capacitance will be measured because you are measuring with this, with respect to this ball and with respect to this base. So that is going to change, and that change will be proportional to the thickness. Now next sensor is the liquid level sensor that we are going to measure. So the liquid level sensor that may use the resistive type of sensor or optical magnet type of sensor or a capacitive sensor. So here it is the example that we have already seen in our previous lecture, a resistive type of sensor. So when the liquid goes on increasing, so this float is may be here, and this float will be here, and this float will be here, and that will be connected to this pivot, and this pivot will move over this one. So it may be here, then it will be connected over here. So resistance is going to change according to level. So this is how a resistive type of level sensor will work. Then this is a optical magnetic type of sensor where you will be passing the light, and when the it is there in air, then at that time obviously the reflection will be different. So we know the concept of refraction. So this is going to change, and that refraction will cause the output to change, and that output will be proportional to. Now here you can see that here when it is in air, it is directly get reflected back from here, but when it comes over here, so there is a reflection refraction because of the change in material, and you can easily find out the depth accordingly. So the reflected wave, you can find it out, and that reflected wave is proportional to the depth of your level. And here it is the capacitive sensor. We have already seen it in our previous lectures also. So the height is proportional to the capacitance, and this capacitance is going to change as the liquid is changing. So when the liquid will reach over here, so this will be also get filled up, and that is going to change the capacitance C1 and C2. So C1 and C2, it depends upon this height of the liquid. So you are measuring it with respect to H0, and accordingly the overall capacitance is going to change, and that overall capacitance is proportional to the level of the water level, or whatever may be the material liquid you are measuring. So it is proportional to that one. So the choice of the particular sensor depends upon many factor, probably what type of liquid you are measuring or the level you want to measure. Depending on that, you have to choose a particular sensor. So one of the most challenging is liquid gas, or especially liquid helium. If you want to measure the level of a liquid helium, that will be a most challenging task. Why? Because it consists a low density and a low dielectric constant. Then in that case, it is very difficult to measure the level of the liquid helium that is present in the your tank. So here we came to the end of a position, displacement and level type of sensors that are used for measurement. So we have seen the various sensors that are related to the position, displacement, then and as well as level. So position, level and displacement, that we have seen the various principles that are related with this one. So we may use the resistive principle, we may use the capacitive principle, we may use the optical principle, we may use the light. So various principles or Hall effect. So such magnetic as well as inductive also. So you can see that the majority principle you can apply for such kind of applications. So I'll stop here. If you have any query, you can put it on YouTube. I will try to answer your queries. Now I have changed my channel. So you can log in to the Tech Funda channel, and Tech Funda's where you can find all those videos, which are initially with my email ID. Now it has been changed to the channel, YouTube channel called as a Tech Fundas. So please subscribe the channel take pandas. Thank you.